to 700 Club Interactive. No matter how hard we try to cover them, we all have weaknesses. And whether they're physical, mental, or emotional, they can hinder us from reaching our potential and even achieving our dreams.
Jason Gray's dream was to be a singer. However, he had a very big obstacle standing in his way, one that would prevent most performers from succeeding. Watch this.
My name is Jason Gray, and I'm a wanderer and wanderer and writer of songs. I suffer from a speech handicap known as stuttering. There it is right there. And I forget my name. Remind me who I am. In the mirror, all I see is who I don't want. My speech impediment is a genetic disorder that lies dormant in you and is activated by a traumatic event. In my life, that was when my dad left and my parents divorced when I was a first grader. I didn't grow up in a churched home, you know. How was I aware of the Lord? The only way I know how to answer that is ever since I was a little boy, I just sensed His presence in my life, and I would just spend time in conversation with this God that I don't know how I knew about Him, except for I believe that that He made Himself known to me, you know. My mom remarried a man. He was a wicked man who dabbled in the occult. He dealt drugs out of our basement. Over time, as things escalated, you know, he became more and more aggressive, emotionally abusive. I remember a Christmas Eve, she called some friends of hers who came to our house and packed us up, and in the middle of the night on Christmas Eve when I was 15 years old, we drove to Colorado where we hid out from him for about a month, you know, and it was in that time where I began to surrender to the Lord's calling me, his pursuing me, you know. That was when I fully surrendered to what he'd been doing in my life all along. Most of us are so afraid and anxious over our weaknesses, you know. And I'm so grateful that because I talk weird, it gives me access to that place in people's hearts, you know. Fear will take the best of us, then come back for the rest of us. It's raging hunger, never satisfied. It's closer than a brother and more jealous than a lover, who holds you while it swallows you alive. And everywhere I go, I get to have this conversation with my audience and to remind them that we are told that it's in our weakness that His strength is perfected, and hopefully to assure them and myself too in the process that I believe He calls us not in spite of our weaknesses, but because of them, you know. This conversation that I get to have with my audience, I hope that it disarms some of the power of fear and shame in people's lives. I'm free. Oh my God, set me free from these chains. I am released. For my God, set me free. In His word, He says that we are chosen, holy and dearly loved, says that we are holy in his sight. Not that we are going to be holy when we get our act together, but right now, because of the work of Christ, holy in his sight, without blemish, free from accusation. And the one that blows my mind most of all says that because of Christ, we become the righteousness of God, you know. If we can allow that to sink its roots deep down in us, this idea that we are God's beloved, that he treasures us, that changes everything, you know, because it is the answer to our fears, it is the answer to our shame, it is the answer to the worst that we've known and experienced. It's the good news. It's the best news that I know, you know. One of the things that I'm most grateful for about what the gospel offers us is it gives us a place to bring our brokenness, the worst that hell and the world has thrown our way to destroy our lives. If we keep bringing it to the Lord, he takes those things and turns them around and uses them against hell to build his kingdom, you know. If you've gone through addiction or depression or divorce or failure or abuse in your history or a speech handicap, whatever it might be, you know, it equips you to be able to bring his mercy to other people who go through the exact same thing, you know. And so I'm grateful that in the kingdom of God there isn't anything wasted. The worst that we go through, at the very least, it's not meaningless, you know. It will be repurposed and redeemed. There isn't anything, I believe, that is beyond the redemptive reach of God. There isn't anything that he can't take and make beautiful and meaningful, you know.
It's from the deepest wounds that beauty finds a place to bloom, and you will see before the end that every broken piece is gathered in the heart of Jesus, and what's lost will be found again. Nothing is wasted, nothing is wasted in the hands of our Redeemer. Nothing is wasted.
Nothing is wasted. Nothing is wasted in the hands of our Redeemer. He brings all things. He uses all things. All things work together for good for those that loved him and are called according to his purpose. Now, just listening to Jason's story, all these other biblical echoes came to my mind, where here's Moses standing in front of a burning bush saying, God, you've got the wrong guy. I don't speak well. I stammer. And God's response to him, who made mouths? And just let that sink into you. Who made you? And is his strength really made perfect in your weakness? Or Jeremiah saying to God, sorry, God, can you come a little later? I'm too young. You know, Caleb didn't say, I'm too old. But the father of John the Baptist did. The angel appeared to him in the temple and said, I'm here to answer your prayer. And as you wanted a child, I'm here to answer that. You're going to have it. Your wife's going to have a child. And he says, well, I'm sorry, you came too late. You know, that prayer was a long time ago. Start thinking of the things that you've used to disqualify yourself from service, to say you're not fit, you're not good enough. You know, maybe you've been abused. Maybe you were an abuser. Maybe you went through divorce. Maybe you went through an addiction. But start thinking that his strength is made perfect in your weakness. And what you've been through and what you've experienced can actually help someone else. And when you think that God is with you, when you start thinking that, when God is for you, who can be against you? Who can make a charge against you when God has justified you? And when you start thinking that, you get released into the incredible possibilities that God wants to bring to earth. He wants his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Here's a final thought for you. At the point where Jesus was broken, where he was bleeding, where he was dying, where he was betrayed, where he was abandoned, when he was all alone, well, that was the point of his greatest ministry. Coming up, an inner city mentor finds the key to teach his young people right after this.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Andreas and Aliyah are two lucky kids. They have a great mentor named Ronald Mayfield. And Ronald likes to have fun with them and teach them about the Bible. Here's how he does both at the same time.
Ronald Mayfield has been volunteering to help inner city kids for over 20 years. For two of his favorite students, Andreas and Aliyah, he's much more than a volunteer.
I'm not in the family, but I'm part of the family. I would consider myself to be a mentor to them because I like to teach them things.
His favorite thing to teach? Stories from the Bible. So when Ronald learned about the new and improved Superbook on the 700 Club, he grabbed the DVDs as soon as he could to share with Andreas and Aliyah. He believes they're learning lessons they'll never forget.
They enjoyed learning about Jesus. They wanted to hear more about it on their level, which made it more interesting to them.
Andreas learned so much from the creation episode, he wrote a letter to the 700 Club. Here's what it had to say.
This episode of Superbook was very good. I liked the part when Michael pushed Satan and fell off the rock.
And Aliyah loves the Superbook trading cards that come with each video. The Bible stories are just part of Superbook's appeal. They're created with the latest in animation technology, sure to capture the attention of this generation's kids.
No! I would recommend it for families, for mothers, parents, okay, single parents, to get Superbook for their children.
I can't wait when another Superbook comes out so I can watch it and learn some more about the Bible.
Well, the wait is over. Another Superbook episode is out. It's called Exodus, Let My People Go. And what we're asking for is, will you help us with the production? We're trying to produce as many as 104 episodes. Right now, we're committed to 26 of them to take the Bible stories to the children of the world. And if you want to be a part of it, we're asking for your help. So for a gift of $25 or more, we'll send out to you Exodus, Let My People Go, the latest version of the Superbook episodes. We're going to have 13 completed by June of next year, and we need help to get it done. This is quite an incredible process we're in to produce these wonderful animated stories to bring the Bible to the children of the world. Our hope is that over the next 5 years, 300 million children will watch these programs. And we want to produce them in 18 different languages. Those are the languages we have planned out over the next 18 months. So if you want to be a part of it, call us right now. 888-777-1999. Just say, yes, I want to help with Superbook. For a gift of $25, we'll send Let My People Go out to you right away. Well, up next, a man with a third grade reading level graduates with a master's degree. You don't want to miss this one.
Yeah. I don't know what I stood for. I don't know what my goals were, my dreams.
His severe memory loss had doctors baffled.
Those memories are there, but he can't actively retrieve them.
Not just from one bad fall, but years of sports-related head injuries that went undetected and untreated.
We also have learned the more concussions you have, they become cumulative and the more damage they do.
How to recognize the signs of a concussion on the 700 Club next.
You may not know it, but each year there will be at least 8,000 new cases of cerebral palsy, and with the possibility of a life confined to a wheelchair, life can look very bleak for its victims. However, there are people who refuse to be defined by their disability, and Clay Rushing is one of them.
Clay Rushing has never walked, made coffee, or tied his own shoes, but some call him a hero. Others say he's an inspiration.
I have cerebral palsy. It's a condition of the brain. I had a lack of oxygen at birth. We don't know exactly why, but parts of my brain were damaged. I'm a quadriplegic.
When he was 19, Clay overcame his disabilities and went to college.
Going through all school, I was given an attendant. They would write notes for me, and they would, read to me.
He first heard about Regent from his two Christian friends.
They just announced out of the blue, "Clay, we want you to come with us to Regent University."
They wanted to hear an evangelist speaking on campus and invited him to come along. When Clay heard the evangelist speak, he made a life-changing decision.
Then he talked about the Holy Spirit and Jesus as if it was the most natural thing in the world. I said, "Lord, okay. If this guy is for real, I want what he's got." I responded to the invitation. I felt the fire of God come upon me. It started at my feet, and the heat traveled all the way up my body.
Now a follower of Jesus Christ, Clay was eager to study in Regent School of Divinity in the master's program.
There are several people that kept me focused and let me know that I was in the right place. One was Dr. Flynn.
The curriculum here in the School of Divinity is difficult. It's challenging. There's a lot of reading, a lot of assignments to do. And Clay never came to us and said, "What can I get out of?" or what special help are you going to offer me?"
Another mentor was Roger Cheeks.
Clay is one of my heroes. Every obstacle that faces Clay Rushing, he finds a way, with the help of God, to overcome those obstacles.
He graduated in 2010 with his master's degree. While at Regent, Clay fell in love with a PhD student, Lynette. 2 years later, they married.
I trusted our relationship, and I knew that I loved Clay, but I also knew it would be challenging. I knew that I was taking on a lot more than most wives would be. Because Clay's in a wheelchair, because of his cerebral palsy, he has had this amazing path where he was able to really get to know the Lord and to think time after time again, he has pushed through and said, "I refuse to let society define me. I refuse to let the fact that I'm in this wheelchair define me." It's just so inspiring to me.
Clay is starting his own ministry and will face this with the same determination that has brought him thus far.
It's not about the physical, it's about the spirit. Life in the spirit is so rich, so powerful. And whether I am sitting in this chair or running around the room or not, that doesn't matter. I never want to be defined by my disability. Never. Never doubt the goodness and the mercy and the power of our God. Never. Never.
know the interesting thing? When we don't allow ourselves to be defined by whatever our inability or adversity might be, then other people don't see us that way either. Clay is an inspiration. He really, really is.
All right. Absolutely. Ready for some phone calls? Here's Connie from Oregon. Hi, Connie.
Hi. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm okay. I'm good. Thank you.
Good.
Okay. I have a prayer request. I have AFib, and for 2 years I've been taking medication, and I hate the medication because it, I feel like it makes me really foggy in my mind. You know, I can't. But anyway, it was controlling the AFib. It would keep my heart rate in the low 70s. And in the last month, I call it like it's bled through. My heart rate's been up, and it stays like between 98 and 100 pretty much all the time, even with the medication. So I would like to ask the Lord to heal me and also give me wisdom as to what steps I should follow. I guess I don't feel like you can just get a miracle and then carry on. Maybe there's things I need to change in my life, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Well, let's deal with that. Is there anything causing you stress, Connie?
There's finances, and we have some family things. And I would like to be what the Lord would have me be in my life, and I think that would solve the stress.
Yeah, that would, but I tell you, I hear a lot of guilt and self-condemnation in you just saying that.
Yeah.
You know, if Connie's trying to be perfect, boy, you're gonna be beating that one for a long time, aren't you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now I'm crying.
All right. Who's perfect, Connie?
No one. The Lord.
Yeah. So when Jesus comes in, it's a wonderful exchange. In exchange for your imperfection, in exchange literally for your flesh, you get the righteousness of God in Christ.
Yeah.
And that's a wonderful word, that righteousness. It literally means you become the perfection of God, what God originally intended. And it's one of the great, that's why we call it the good news. It's one of the great transactions in history, is that I get to change all my mess and say, here, Jesus, you take this, and now you come to me, and I become the righteousness of God in Christ. You know, he, one of his wonderful titles, he is the justifier of the ungodly. He's the justifier of the imperfect. He's the one who allows you to stand in the throne room perfect, as if you've never done anything wrong, as if everything you are doing now is right, and you get to come into his presence and be perfect. It's great. It's great news.
That's amazing.
But if it's up to Connie, if Connie's got to be perfect, well, okay, you got a long way to go, don't you?
Not possible.
So, all right. So stop. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, understand what Jesus means, that you can enter into his rest. Come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That means just stop working. And you stop looking at all the things you're doing wrong or not right or not good enough or you didn't do this, and all this kind of stuff. You just leave it all because you don't need to anymore. Jesus is taking care of all of that. Now, does Jesus have your future?
Yes.
All right. Is he going to do a good job?
Yes.
Yeah. He who has begun a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. Now, he's not going to leave you either. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. He will not leave you orphaned. You're not going to be orphaned anymore. He's going to not just be with you, he's going to send the Comforter as well, who will be your helper. And he will be your very present help in time of need. So if you've got family issues, if you've got financial issues, all right, stop working and just start resting in him and listen. You know, just listen to him. He's going to give you some good ideas. He's going to speak to you. He's going to tell you what to do. He's going to say, this is the way, walk in it. And he'll do that. He'll be unfailing with it. But don't for a minute think that Connie can add to it. It's not by works, lest anyone should boast. It's not going to be, You know, Connie's works, prayer, fasting, all the other things we try to do to get good with God or get in with God, they don't work. Prayer's good, fasting's good, but it's all about who are you doing it for and why are you doing it? And if you're doing it because of love and love of God and you want to get close to Him, that's a really good reason. If you're trying to earn brownie points with God, really bad reason. So stop. It's when you let the Holy Spirit, when you let Jesus come in and He starts working in you, that's when you take on the divine nature. That's when you change. And then you start understanding it's Him who is willing you to work. And that's the proper work in the body of Christ. When it's His will and it's motivated by His love, then you get it.
Okay, thank you.
Boy, I hear a change in your voice already.
Yeah. Yes.
All right, now.
Thank you.
Is it God's will to heal?
Yes.
Okay. It's the great Lord's Prayer. We're supposed to pray, Our Father who art in heaven, you know, we're supposed to pray, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Yes.
Okay? Now, in heaven, is anybody sick?
No.
Anybody anxious?
No.
Anybody having family trouble?
No.
Anybody worried about how they're going to pay the bills?
No.
Okay. So that's God's will. And the great thing is He said, and He's given us the authority and the power to say, Thy will be done on earth. All right? And so we're going to take that a step further and say, Thy will be done in Connie.
Thank you.
Thy will be done in Connie's family. Thy will be done with Connie's finances. Thy will be done with Connie's heart rate.
Amen.
And we're going to pray that right now. Lord, for Connie, we just claim Your will be done in her heart right now. Her will be done with the atrial beats of her heart. Your will be done, and peace come to Connie right now. The peace that passes all understanding, I just ask that it would just wash through her and be all around her. And we ask for specific healing for the nerves that lead to the heart and the impulses that lead to the heart, that everything would be healed and would be normal. And we speak new strength and new vitality and new energy. And Lord, we just ask for all the confusion and fatigue from the medication to leave her now and be gone and new life. You came that Connie might have life and have it more abundantly. So we speak that over her now. And Lord, I just ask that You would open an incredible door of rest for her and all the weariness of her anxiety and all that heavy burden and heavy laden would just be rolled off of Connie and onto You, for we know that You care for her. So we cast all these burdens, all these cares, all this anxiety on Connie. And we just ask for Your peace and Your rest to wash over her now.
Thank You.
Lord, I speak deep sleep and peace for her through every night of her life. Let her sleep the sleep of the justified. Let her going out be accompanied by Your peace. When she comes home, let there be rejoicing in her home. Let peace be all around her. And just wrap around her like a blanket, that she would be a bringer of peace and a receiver of peace. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Connie.
Appreciate your prayers.
And God bless you.
Thank you.
And you have a great day.
I will, and you too.
All right.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thanks for watching. That's all the time we have for this program. We leave you this word from 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I take pleasure in my weaknesses, And in the insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ, for when I am weak, then I am strong. God bless you. We'll see you.